before Denny Crum arrived.
Denny Crum defined Louisville basketball for a generation. The Hall of Fame coach was revered for his dominance on the court.
He took a school that had a nice program. I mean, it wasn't like they weren't successful. They had some winning seasons, but he brought it to a whole new level.
Denny Crum does it again.
He changed how the game was played on his way to 6 Final Fours, winning 2 national championships.
Coach was extraordinary because he made others better.
But his lasting legacy extends far beyond the hardwood. Coach Crum changed the lives of his players.
He actually gave me an opportunity to be who I am today, so I could not be here without him.
And countless others through his charity work.
What you see is what you get. He's a very sincere, loving, caring person. And just, you know, everybody loves Coach.
He brought prominence to the Louisville basketball program and pride to Card Nation that's never diminished. Denny Crum, a Louisville legend. Thank you for joining us tonight. Coach Denny Crum achieved just about everything as a college basketball coach, from Final Fours and national championships to the Hall of Fame.
But he accomplished so much more off the basketball court, giving back to those who cheered for and even against him.
And tonight, we're looking back at the Louisville legend's impact and legacy and hearing from those who knew him best.
Denny Crum coached the Cardinals for 30 years, bringing the University of Louisville to prominence.
The program has seen its ups and downs since he left the bench, but he never left the community that became his home.
Absolutely one of kind, yeah. Generous, loving, caring, kind. Understanding, you wouldn't find a more patient man as a coach and a person than Coach Crum. I mean, he was all that.
Denny Crum is remembered by former players, coaches, and the community as one of a kind. Coach Crum made history at Louisville, bringing U of L basketball in the city of Louisville their first NCAA championship in 1980. The first title came 9 years after Crum took over the job.
They knew that we were capable. And when it came together and it worked, I think they could see more success down the road.
And the program had more success because of Denny Crum, including a second national title in 1986. In total, over his time leading the Cards, Coach Crum won 2 national championships, 6 Final Fours, and 675 wins in a 30-year run. And all his success put him in the Sports Hall of Fame. But for former players, Coach Crum meant even more off the court.
You learn so much from someone like a Coach Crum. The X's and O's, absolutely. But the life lessons, right? So important. Okay, just so important. He taught me how to give back.
Coach Crum actually saved my. He actually gave me an opportunity to be who I am today. So I could not be here without him, and he's largely responsible for what I've become.
Coach Crum was known as an incredibly competitive man, and he always pushed his players to be better. But it was how he got everyone to work together and win together. Players say they remember the most.
I know one of the first things that I really witnessed was the fact that he never yelled. And the whole time I was on the basketball team, I never heard him say a curse word. It was just his demeanor.
And while Coach Crum was a Hall of Famer, analyst Bob Valvano described him as an even better teacher, and not just about the game, but about the life lessons that come from it.
He rose above it all. It was like, I am who I am, and I'm not going to be taken away from that just because there's some people that are, for whatever reason, have their own motives to try and denigrate me or something. He was just, he was Denny Crum, and I loved him, man.
Denny Crum loved Louisville, and the city loved him right back.
I hope they remember that I really cared about Louisville. I loved Louisville. I loved the people here.
And the people here loved him as well. What a legacy he leaves behind.
Special for sure.
And Fred, he even impacted other programs in the city.
Exponentially so, across the board. Scott Davenport learned the game as a Cards assistant under Denny Crum, and he influenced the Bellarmine basketball head coach in everything he has done since.
5-6 weeks ago, on a Sunday, went in my office and penned a very, very, very long letter to Coach. And when I walked out that day, I felt good.
because if Bellarmine basketball is built on that saying about never delay gratitude, why would I not say thank you? And now, you know, as things go, you think what Coach built was on one premise. It was built on the premise that very seldom, if ever, would the five best players make the best team. So the emphasis was on team. And Fred, I have said this throughout this day to anybody who would listen. I challenge you, name me one person he said no to. Never said no. So the coach teacher and Coach Crum would say, let's everybody in this community learn from that. And there has not been a day go by in my career from the moment as a walk-on JV player in 1976 to a coaching career that's going in 2023 that my life has not been impacted by Coach Crum. People ask me his strongest strength. Well, he was a math major, so he's very analytical. And it didn't have to be, well, shoot, you had bank shot above the block, it would be at a 45-degree angle. And but at the end of the day, there was a right way and a wrong way to play. And from a fundamental standpoint, passed on from Coach Wooden to Coach Crum, on and on and on, there was a right way and a wrong way to play. But it was always about team. And his love from this community, to be an L.A. transplant here, and to embrace this community, and to care about this community is something that I've embraced my whole life. I challenge it. Let's learn from him right now, today. We're being challenged in this community right now. Let's follow the ultimate master, teacher, slash coach, and let's make others better in this community. What if we just never said no and we just go help someone? I'm gonna say this to you, Fred. I won't get through this. 18 years at Bellarmine, I have received texts all day today from former Bellarmine players who never met Coach Crum. But they were asked to study about him, and they have reached out, Coach, are you okay? I know how much he meant to you. So those players know what he meant to me. So now it was passed on to them. They never met him, but they were caring. People said, oh, you coached under him. Man, you learned from Coach Crum. And sometimes I look myself in the mirror because one of his strongest virtues was patience. And anybody seen me coach, I may have failed in that regard. And I'm like, Coach, but I couldn't be Coach Crum. I couldn't be Coach Patino. I had to be Scott Davenport. But to have these type individuals like a Coach Crum impact my life, I'm thankful every single day. And people make fun of me about the never delay gratitude saying at Bellarmine. Well, I'm thankful every day.
And we are thankful for him. After leaving Louisville, Scotty's led Bellarmine basketball to a Division II national title and a transition to Division I. And Scotty says much of it is due to what he learned from Coach Crum.
And Coach Crum also touched the life of Kenny Klein. The former U of L sports information director worked for four men's basketball coaches and talked to Mark Vanderhoff about getting his start with Denny Crum.
He was just such a gentleman at all times.
Kenny Klein first began working with Denny Crum in 1983.
He embraced me right from the start. A young guy that had a lot to learn, and he really embraced me. And I just can't say enough about him as a person.
Crum had already cemented his reputation by then.
He got us to six Final Fours, but it started in his first year. You know, 71-72 season, he led U of L to the Final Four, and I remember talking to him about it. Coach, what was that like to go the first year? He's like, well, I came from UCLA. I thought you were supposed to do that every year.
And Klein says fans knew his mannerisms.
Some of his sayings that he had that he kind of pulled from John Wooden a lot of times, the be quick, don't hurry, going up the sidelines with the rolled program.
Crum was recognizable, and Klein says he was always generous with those fans.
I actually started carrying pen in my pocket, a Sharpie in my pocket, because he got stopped so many times for autographs and pictures and what have you.
Klein says Crum was also generous with the Louisville community, serving on local nonprofit boards and raising money for scholarships.
Just every little thing in the community, you know, whether it's a, you know, so many times a hospital visit, you know, just hey, you know, this guy was such a great Coach Crum fan or whatever, and he'd stop by and do those things that never get talked about or heard about, but he did those often.
Mothers, daddies, family, teachers.
Denny Crum's legacy at Louisville went well beyond basketball.
He also impacted players that he never coached. Dominic Yates caught up with UofL great Luke Hancock, who shared memories of his time with the coach.
The basketball stuff is great, but you start to realize the type of person he is and the impact that he had, and that's what's really special, I think.
Denny Crum was long retired when Luke Hancock arrived at the University of Louisville in 2012. But it didn't take long for the George Mason transfer to learn of Crum's impact.
Well, I certainly didn't think he owed us anything or had a reason to come connect with our group, but he certainly went out of his way to just have an interaction with us, you know, to spend 30 minutes sitting at the table and hearing stories from Coach Crum. I felt like a little kid. You know, I said it earlier, he was such a legend. He's such a titan in the game of college basketball. He could have been William Wallace. He could have been 8 feet tall. And so for him to sit down and just spend a little time with us, it was so impactful for me.
The 2013 Final Four Most Outstanding Player does work on the ACC Network and weekly radio on ESPN 93.9 The Ville. On this somber day, fans shared uplifting stories about the coach.
He talked to me like he talked to me all, known me all his life.
Story after story was told about a memorable encounter with the Hall of Fame coach, showing his legacy goes beyond basketball.
I was very fortunate to go do the Final Four experience with the ACC Network and Joel Berry and Carlos Boozer and see the Duke and Carolina Brotherhoods. Denny Crum is responsible for the Louisville Brotherhood. I think it's going to be impossible for us to grasp what this man means to this university, has meant to this university, and I just pray it's going to continue to be that way. I'm happy his name is all over the place because he certainly deserves it.
UofL announcer Paul Rogers had a front row seat during the Denny Crum era.
He talked to Brett Del Barba about getting an up-close look at how Denny Crum coached and the impact that he had on his players.
He just became such a Louisville institution and a part of this community, and something that he nor anybody else, I think, ever really saw coming, because he came here wanting to get a little bit of head coaching experience so he could go be the head coach at UCLA, and came here and never left. He just liked it too much. He didn't want to leave, and nobody wanted to leave, and fortunately he stayed to the very end.
From Los Angeles to Louisville, the Hall of Fame head coach fully immersed himself in the community beyond coaching the Cardinals.
He didn't just come here and say, this is a great place, I'm going to grab what I can. He came back, never turned down an autograph, never said no to a charity, was just totally engaged and involved in the community to where this hotshot from Southern California became a Louisville icon.
Coach Crum carried a calm demeanor along the sidelines.
He was never a guy to rant and rave and go into histrionics. I can't ever remember having a crossword with him after a post-game interview, or no matter how disappointing the loss was. He might be disappointed, but he understood it's a game. It's a competition. One team's going to win, one team's going to lose. He always credited the opponent. He would point out his team's shortcomings, but he always did it in a sporting, gentlemanly way, and I think people really appreciated that.
For 30 years, Paul Rogers had a front row seat as the UofL announcer. From the 675 wins to being crowned a two-time national champion, it's the moments and relationships away from the game that remain with Rogers the most.
It was fun to watch. It was fun to watch his interactions with players and players' reactions to him. You know, sometimes he would say things that players didn't like, but that's a coach's job. He has to point out the right things, and it was always fun to be in close enough proximity to observe those things and see those things and see the relationships he had with players. And all you have to do is talk to any player today, and there's no question about the loyalty and the love they have for their coach.
And Kenny Payne is trying to fill the big shoes of the man who coached him at Louisville. He's reflecting on Coach Crum's passing in a statement, saying in part, "My thoughts go through all the lessons that he taught, not just to me, but every player he ever came in contact with. Those lessons are still relevant today." Coach Payne went on to say, "We were so blessed to have him in our lives. He was a true treasure who gave so much to university and the community. We must keep his memory alive. He is in a better place. Rest in peace, Coach. You touched so many. Well done."
Denny Crum's teams helped change the game as we know it, bringing fans to their feet with highlights, slam dunks. We look back in our archives at the Doctors of Dunk.
If you grew up in Louisville, chances are you remember this moment. That championship was 15 years after Coach Crum came to Louisville.
Yeah, Coach Crum grew up in Southern California and was part of the dynasty that John Wooden built at UCLA in the 60s and 70s with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Bill Walton. When he got here, he took those lessons and turned Louisville into a powerhouse.
Time now to take you into the WLKY archives for a look at this legendary career. Here's a former member of our sports team, Dave Reynolds.
It was the late Al McGuire who gave Denny Crum the nickname Cool Hand Luke for the way he performed under pressure. 3 years after leading Louisville to the Final Four in his first season, he was back. U of L squared off against Crum's alma mater, UCLA, in the 1975 Final Four. To top it off, the Bruins were guided by Crum's mentor, John Wooden. However, on this day, the teacher beat the pupil as UCLA won the game and went on to capture Wooden's 10th and last national championship. But Crum would get another chance. led by the spectacular Daryl Griffith and the rest of a fun-loving cast of characters known as the Doctors of Dunk, Louisville went 33-3 and beat UCLA to win the 1980 national title.
Louisville's 33-3 record becomes the second most wins by an NCAA champion.
U of L remained among the nation's elite programs for the next several years. Then, in 1986, thanks to an enormous contribution from a skinny freshman center nicknamed Never Nervous, the Cards rose to the top again, beating Duke to give Crum his second and, as it turned out, last national championship.
The Cardinals have won the national championship. Denny Crum does it again.
Then, after six more NCAA appearances, Crum took his place among the sport's all-time greats. On May 9th, 1994, he was named to the Basketball Hall of Fame.
John Wooden and his pupil, Denny Crum.
Oh, what a night.
Yeah.
The slam dunk is a highlight in basketball, but there was a time when it was actually illegal.
Yeah, but when the NCAA brought it back, Coach Crum's teams embraced it. The 1980 team, as you've heard throughout this story tonight, the nickname Doctors of Dunk was the team. Here's a former member of our sports team, Keith Farmer, on this.
Oh, what's in your mouth? Here's your miracle. Stand up and fight. This is it.
They were best known as the Doctors of Dunk.
Dunks for those guys were 100% shots, and I like 100% shots.
The smallest guys on the team, like Tony Branch and Greg Duser, those guys could dunk. Everybody on the team could dunk.
I'm a creative type of individual, and I like to let my creative juices flow when time permits.
It's tipped out, picked up by Derek Smith. Here goes Griff. It's dunk time. Woo! What a play by Griffith.
1980 was a year that saw U of L claim its first ever NCAA men's college basketball title. One that the school's all-time leading scorer, Daryl Griffith, promised to deliver to his hometown. The senior led a lineup that featured three sophomores and a freshman to a 59-54 title game victory over UCLA. That was head coach Denny Crum's alma mater.
To this day, even if I would have won an NBA championship, nothing would have been as special as winning the national championship here at the University of Louisville.
Daryl Griffith had led all scorers with 23 points, and he had kept his promise of bringing home the NCAA title to his hometown of Louisville, Kentucky.
You know, it wasn't all about, quote-unquote, me, the star player. It was team. You know, my teammates know that. You know, I praise my teammates all the time.
His teammates definitely had their moments. Freshman Rodney McCray stepped up after his older brother, Scooter, suffered a season-ending knee injury in the third game. Senior guard Tony Branch, a starter the year before, accepted his reduced role. And then, with Griffith on the bench with five fouls, his roommate hit the game winner against Kansas State in the second round of the NCAAs.
He's got a shot coming. It is up. It is good by Tony Branch.
And then there was the high five, which Georgia natives Derek Smith and Wiley Brown claim to have invented during that championship season.
Derek said one day, just all out of clear blue, said, give me a high five. And I hadn't heard it before, but we did, and it became national.
Brown was also at the center of one of college basketball's great stories. After losing the tip of his thumb as a child, he was fitted with a prosthetic at U of L. On the morning of the championship game, he left the new thumb on his breakfast tray.
So we had to get all the trainers and managers and everybody to go through the trash, and they found it, and the rest was history.
It was a unified effort because we needed that thumb bad.
With stories like that and dunks like this, U of L burst onto the national scene, a scene made even more profitable by the birth of national cable television.
The ESPN Sports Center is next. Write them up.
The bottom line is they became a fashion model in the way of dunking the basketball in terms of college basketball 2 decades ago. Really, we're really a very unique team that understood how to play as well. They just weren't dunkers. They flat out knew how to play the game.
It's here, the moment is now. Oh, what's in your mouth? Here's your miracle. Stand up and fight. This is it.
Wonderful memories for sure. Many former players got into coaching and even stayed in Louisville because of Coach Crum. Pride and joy of Ballard High School's Jerry Eaves joins us in studio to talk about the coach's impact on his life and career.
You can't judge a career on the basis of any one game, either on or any one year, on the basis of winning it all or losing it all. I mean, a career is a career. It's a total combination of everything that you've done and accomplished, and I feel good about my career, both on and off the floor of basketball.
It wasn't one game or one season, but an entire career. Coach Crum received the distinction of becoming a Hall of Famer. We're joined now by Louisville native Jerry Eaves, who played for Coach Crum and was part of the 1980 National Championship team. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Great to see you, man. Thanks for coming in.
No question.
How are you absorbing this day? We knew it was coming, Jerry, but it just still bites, doesn't it?
When I spoke with Susan today, around 12 or so, kind of sank in that Coach was gone, but life well lived. Mm-hmm. The nicest gentleman in the world. Better person than he was a basketball coach, not close. And he was a Hall of Fame coach. There's nothing else you can say.
You're with him as a player and mm-hmm. assistant coach.
Absolutely.
Talk about those differences, or were there differences, and what did he mean in your life?
Well, he recruited me. So I was the first recruit in 1978. We went in 80. Derek Smith, Wiley Brown, Scooter McRae, Poncho Wright, myself. And he was the same person in 78 that he was in 80, that he was when I worked for him in 96, that he was 3 or 4 weeks ago when I saw him. Aww. The most humble individual you'll ever run across. He was selfless. It was everybody first, him second, was always.
Father figure, I mean, so we've heard so many different angles to the players and how he impacted them.
Well, again, when I went to work for him, I had two younger sons, my boys, and he told me the most important thing in life are them. He says they're more than welcome at every practice, every game, anytime you bring them with you, because that's your job. It wasn't go get recruits, save University of Louisville, we have to win. It was my family. Never. All the plane rides. It was never about Louisville. It was just about life. Being a good person, talking about John Wood and what he meant to him. Coach Crum has touched so many lives, just not his players, but the players' sons and daughters and their sons and daughters, the managers. I mean, he came here from California and stayed. Mm-hmm. He could have chased the money.
Yeah.
But certainly. He didn't.
Jerry, Terry Howard used to always say, I said, what was his key to success? He said, well, you know, he just would draw it up and said, if you do this, we can succeed. And we believed him. Is that what it was? Just the players believed in him?
Well, it was more than that. Coach Crum was the best.
Well,
I mean, I'm just being honest with you. He was the best X and O guy in the business. Mm. There's no doubt about it. He was setting up plays, 5 and 6 plays before the final play.
Really?
People had no idea. They were like, he drew up the play. No, he didn't. He had run part A, part B, part C, part D. We all knew it was coming. He was the best in the business at setting up the very next play. He just was 10 or 11 plays ahead of all the coaches
wow.
and the players, and we all knew it. All we had to do was follow the directions. And then he gave it to you like ice cream and cake. I mean, I coached for 30 years, yeah. and he wrote me up for cursing. When I was an assistant coach
really?
At Louisville, he wrote me up.
Really?
He says, Jerry, don't show your ignorance anymore. He wow. says, they can get it. Communicate correctly. He wrote me up honestly.
Oh,
another commonality in many of the people I've talked to over the last few days about this is self-motivation. He expected you to figure it out. He gave you some responsibility in all this. It wasn't just on him to hold your hand. Mm-hmm. He demanded a lot out of your players. Fair?
That's fair, but it came back from Coach Wooden. Coach Wooden taught Denny. Denny taught me. If you always tell somebody exactly what you want, that's all you're going to get. Just kind of lead them in the right direction. And then hold their feet to the fire, and you'll get 10 things, not one.
Ah.
So they'll just not fix what you want, but they'll fix other things if they want to play and if they're motivated.
And that's
so
where this
very
comes
good.
From. Yeah. I always wondered where that came from.
Mm-hmm.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, so no, he would not just direct you and say, this is what you have to do. He would tell you, you're not doing what I want you to do. It'd be great if you would fix it. And then it was your ability to go out and say, what is he talking about? Figure it out and fix 5 of the things, and all of a sudden the team's a better team.
Out of all those memories that you shared together, the national championship, the coaching, to living here growing up. Mm-hmm. What will you take away, Jerry?
We went to Boston, Massachusetts once, and we drove to Winchendon. I don't know if everybody's ever driven through Massachusetts out from Boston. Beautiful country, but it's late, and we don't have all the maps, and he's got mm-hmm. the map in his hand, and I'm driving.
Mm-hmm.
And we spoke and talked about everything under the sun. Absolutely everything. Why he didn't leave Louisville, why he didn't want to go back to UCLA, why he loved his kid so much, what made Louisville special. Guys, it was never the basketball piece. I'd sit right next to him. He'd read a book every air flight, every time.
Really?
He'd only put the book down when someone would come up to speak with him. He's courteous to everyone. But it was never, he was never drawing up plays, drawing up defensive assignments, ever. It was always he'd read a book and he'd say, Jerry, you need to read more.
Why?
Critical thinking. He says, it's just important. We need to have it. This is 30 years ago. This is 1996. You got me, 97. And it was turbulent times then. Right. Louisville was going through turbulent times.
Yes,
Pat Forty was after us. Everybody remembers the time.
I remember.
It never fazed Coach at all. Mm-mm, not in the least. Just do your job. When we went to work, we did our job. And after that, he put it to bed. One of the very few coaches that did.
That's beautiful memories.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Appreciate
you being here.
No question. Thank you all.
Thank you, Jerry, for those memories of Coach Crum. And it wasn't just his players. Coach Crum had a lasting impact on plenty of other people as well. That includes analyst Bob Valvano, who had a front row seat to the Hall of Famer's career. He talks about the coach's legacy next.
It was not just his players. Coach Crum had a big impact on lots of other people as well.
No doubt about that. That includes analyst Bob Valvano, who had one of the best seats to watch the Hall of Famer's career.
Never confuse what you do with who you are. And you find out who he really was. Because at that point now, he has no ulterior motive. He's retired. He's out of it. And you see, he's still going to charity things in the community. He's still going. He's not trying to win goodwill so that you'll support his team. He doesn't have a team anymore. He's Denny Crum.
Bob Valvano had a unique seat for the Denny Crum era. He's a longtime analyst on UofL basketball radio broadcasts, as well as being a national analyst for ESPN and hosting a local show on ESPN Radio. He also has a unique perspective on Crum and his impact on this community and the sport. Valvano's a former head coach himself at Bellarmine, and his brother Jim Valvano coached against Crum. Bob Valvano says one of Crum's secrets was understanding that sports are a noble and honorable distraction from life's brutal realities. So while Crum wanted to win at everything, Valvano says Denny never forgot there were bigger issues outside the lines.
He was as competitive as they come in charity golf tournaments, in our bocce tournament. I mean, he wanted to win. But he was always so good once the event was over and understanding there's a big world out there and where do I fit in? And I think that's just the greatest message.
Valvano says as much as Crum was a Hall of Fame coach, he was a better teacher, not just about the game, but about the life lessons that come from it. The equity of the experience of being around Crum for years as a peer and broadcaster had a profound impact on Valvano, and it left a long, lasting impression on him.
Just he rose above it all. It was like, I am who I am, and I'm not going to be taken away from that just because there's some people that are, for whatever reason, have their own motives to try and denigrate me or something. He was just, you know, he was Denny Crum, and I love him, man.
Now we take you back to 2007 when Denny Crum Court was unveiled at Freedom Hall.
We stumbled on this afternoon. We found the raw video from that night. We want to share the coach's comments as he revealed the floor with then-athletic director Tom Jurich.
And as you can see on the video wall, Coach Crum even had a hand in painting the floor that now bears his signature.
Priceless video, Vicki.
It certainly is. It's what you like to remember it.
No doubt about it. After the unveiling, Denny took questions during the post-game news conference where he spoke about his love for the fans and the reasons he made Louisville his home.
What was it like being out there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, these people are fantastic. I mean, they're great fans. And like I said, we had a 30-year love affair, and so 35 now, I guess, and it's just been an unbelievable trip. I don't have a single complaint. My life is wonderful. Everything is good, and I'm just about as relaxed and as having as much fun as a guy can have.
When you're sitting up in the stands, you ever get the bangs down the sideline?
He asked if when I'm sitting up in the stands, do I ever get the pang of trying to. What I do is I do what I always did when I watch a game. I analyze everything and I try to figure out what changes I'd make. But then I don't share them with anybody. I keep them to myself. But you can't help when you do it all your life. 41 years I coached. And when you do that, it's just part of what you do when you're at watching a game, even if it's a high school game. You know, you go see these games and you just, that's part of what you are. I mean, that's, and I like I said, I don't share it with anyone because it's not, I mean, I just wouldn't do that. But I always have my opinions. Yeah, that's normal, I think. You don't give up coaching and you don't give up competing when it's been your whole life. I mean, regardless of what it is, I mean, what you're doing, it's the competition part of it is the part that I think I enjoy the most. Actually, I'm a fan. I try to be just a fan, and I don't try to second guess anyone. I just think about what I would do and root for the kids. That's the way I approach it. The opportunities that I had to leave and go other places, I mean, I have to be honest with you, I could have made a lot more money. And when I came here, my intention was to see if I could be successful at this level and then go back to UCLA when Coach Wooden retired. That was what I had in my mind. And then when the opportunity came, I had fallen in love with living here and the lifestyle and the things that you could do and the friends that I made. I didn't stay here because I thought I could do better here than anywhere else. That's not true. I've stayed here because I just love the lifestyle and the people and their interest and love for basketball.
And Coach Crum's legacy is all around the city. Right across the street from the KFC Yum Center is the coach's hometown hero banner. In March, his new banner was placed on the Whiskey Row Lofts. Denny Crum was one of the original honorees.
And Denny Crum's impact is also present on the U of L campus. Last fall, Coach Crum got to celebrate with his former players and current Cardinals as the university opened a new residence hall named after him. It houses not only men's basketball players, but other student athletes as well. In 2018, we were honored to present Coach Crum with a Bell Award from the WLKY Spirit of Louisville Foundation.
Here's our story from that night and the coach's acceptance speech.
It makes you feel good to know that you can help other people. I think that's the key for me. I've made a conscious effort ever since I've been here to not only get myself involved, but my teams. I'm proud of it, and I'm happy to see my players be a part of it. And my wife is a big part of it, too. My participation is a participation, kind of a, I don't know, a love from my heart to them. They're labors of love, and we do whatever we can do. And it's probably not enough, but it's the best we can do. I mean, we do everything we can, and it makes you feel better, makes you feel good.
We are happy that you're here on such a beautiful day.
This is really worth doing. This is it's not just a fun thing, it's just a way of life that you have to, some people have to learn to live a different way of life. And you can't always have everything the way you want it. And when you find out that this is what it takes to be successful at curing or making those kind of problems go away, it makes you feel so good, you just want to do more and more. And that's the way I feel, and my wife Susan feels the same way.
Your time is valuable and you don't mind giving it to help others.
No, I don't mind giving it. It's just a labor of love. I told Susan, I don't know what I'm gonna say when I get up here. And I think that's
that's really a good thing, because I don't have to write out how I feel about this community, about the different organizations that we've been involved with and have tried our best to help. Coach Wooden was my coach, and between him and my father, I don't think they would have let me grow up any other way than caring about other people. I'm usually out there in the community doing something, and those three kind of lead me by the hand and take me places, tell me where I'm supposed to be. And, you know, I love every minute of it. I don't know how much longer I've got to give, but as long as I'm going to be here, I'm going to give the best I can possibly give. And I know you do the same, or you wouldn't be here tonight. I applaud you. I appreciate all of you. And I'm just happy to be here. I never thought I could ever receive an award like this. You know, when you're 50 or 60, you think, 80's not so old. So I feel really good about myself. I feel good about my family and those that helped me. And I just want you to know that nothing in this world that I could do would make up for not having tried to do my best. That I can assure you I've done. Thank you so much.
I feel like we should clap all over again.
I know.
The Bell Award is given to outstanding volunteers in our community, and Denny Crum certainly was one.
Yes, he was. This is going to be a hard one to get through. Yeah. The guy was so special to me. He was a friend, a father figure. Got my wood from him, played golf with him, celebrity car races. He would do anything he could for you. He would come here and help us out. There's a picture I'll take from that. We did that interview. Every time you tried to compliment him, he would compliment you back. He was just a super
great
individual.
Great picture.
Love him to death.
A real treasure. I remember meeting him back 2006, 2007 at a charity event. Never met him before. Greeted me with a smile and a handshake like we'd been friends forever.
Yeah.
What a guy.
Speaking of charity events, Denny Crum never said no to WLKY. Mm-hmm. He was here every year for the Wednesday's Child Adopt-A-Thon.
Great picture.
There he is. Aww. He was on the phone bank for us many, many years, raising money for Wednesday's Child. Just a great guy.
Do you remember that year he sang with Lincoln Bridge or was back there at the park just helping him out, clapping?
Well, he was taking a break over there, and it ended up he was part of the gang singing
that was
there.
Good. He was wonderful. What a
character in every room.
Two words come to mind, disarmingly charming. Yeah. He would literally put you at ease right away. And here's a guy that's done an awful lot. When I came here in 1986, I was so intimidated. I said, Fred, come on in. Mm-hmm. The old Crawford gym. And the other two words I think of changed lives. And it wasn't just his players, although you can start there for sure. But it was the people around him, their families. I mean, you talk about player after player at alumni list where their lives are for the better because they were a part of this. And it is hard to get through, but he was a big piece of my life, and I just wanted to say thanks, Coach.
Well, he could be tough, and they said Jerry was talking about the fact that he was tough.
Eastern.
Have you heard anybody say anything bad about this guy?
No.
Never.
That's an excellent point, Vicki.
Yeah.
It really is.
And I think very few people earned the title of Louisville legend, and he is one of two I can think of.
Yes, I agree. I kept thinking of that Mount Rushmore thing, and I know two faces on there, and of course Muhammad Ali would be one, but I think Coach is sitting right there with him.
Absolutely.
No question.
And he loved kids. He'd do anything for kids. Visit him in the hospital, didn't matter. He would give it to anyone.
Made potatoes and baked pizza.
Yes, he did.
He needed potato soup.
He did it all.
To raise the money.
Susan, we're thinking of you tonight as well.
We certainly are. Our hearts and thoughts go out to Denny's family. We are, as Rick said, all of us are thinking of you right now.
And it just seems like yesterday we were doing his retirement party. His players loved him to death then. They love him now.
Been a highlight of our career, all of his milestones that he set.
You can always count on Denny Crum.
Everybody loved him. Louisville loved him.
We thank you for joining us for this special look at Denny Crum's career. We'll see you tonight at 11 o'clock.
That's a love affair, I guess, that I've had, that it is
very rewarding and very pleasing.
No lazy bastards, they'll be frank. The worst thing they'll do is let them battle.
I mean, who knew about Louisville, Kentucky before Denny Crum arrived?
I feel the pressure all the time like everybody else does.
It was all over. Final score, Louisville 59, UCLA 54.
His legacy is that he took a school that had a nice program. I mean, it wasn't like they weren't successful here. They had some winning seasons, but he brought it to a whole new level. And the legacy is the people still demand that level of excellence from the program.
He had incredible confidence, and that confidence filled the room, and it was contagious.
So I said, if you can combine that kind of competitiveness and that kind of graciousness and class, you got something special. And the fact that the way they played, which was, you know, very, very entertaining as a fan. The players loved to play it. I said, this guy's got the whole package, and he did his whole career.
Denny Crum does it again.
He won games by being a very strong, Christian-valued coach. He brought it in the locker room. He took it on the away games. He brought it home to Louisville.
It's hard to really put in a sentence because you learn so much from someone like a Coach Crum. The X's and O's, absolutely. But the life lessons, right?
What he taught was incredible competence that comes from only one place, and that's being prepared.
He built a reputation of being cool, being honest, being a person of high integrity. I think all those things kind of stand out, but the mere fact that he stayed here and stayed committed to this community, stayed committed to the players outside of our basketball days, means a lot to me. So that's what stands out for me anytime I hear his name.
Coach was extraordinary because he made others better.
There's been so many good things that have happened, and to have an opportunity to spend 30 years in a place, it just doesn't happen very often.
Absolutely one of kind, yeah. Generous, loving, caring, kind, understanding, you wouldn't find a more patient man as a coach and a person than Coach Crum.
What he's done as a civic leader, a coach, a father, a husband, a friend, he put Louisville, Kentucky on the map.
I've always felt that if you're going to live in a community, that you need to give back to it. And giving back to it, this is one way I can do that.
Oh, I see him as an absolute wonderful, wonderful man. He is a teacher. He is a... he's just a godsend.
And I love giving to this community who supported me for 30 years.
And the Hall of Famer, Denny Crum.
He just was so effortlessly gracious.
It makes you feel good to know that you can help other people. I think that's the key for me.
You know, he was Denny Crum, and I loved him, and I think we were very lucky.
I don't know anyone else that can do what he's done. You know, I truly don't know how you replace a Denny Crum.
You will not find a more sincere, caring, giving, loving person than Denny Crum.
We love that man.
You know, he is an icon, and obviously a legend, you know, a name that will not just, you know, ever be forgotten. And so his legacy is, as you know, strong, will always be strong. People love Coach.
I hope they remember that I really cared about Louisville. I loved Louisville. I loved the people here.